Good morning, everyone. My name is Pedro Ribeiro. I'll be presenting this sensor that we developed for surface exploration characterization. I would like to thank you for the opportunity of speaking at this workshop. So I'll begin. So our sensor is inspired on the cilia structure. So cilia structure is a biological structure found in many beings, but for sensing purposes, especially in insects. So these, there are these little hairs that you can see here. They have two parts, a passive part, which is like a small hair. It doesn't do anything, but it's attached to a dendrite that sends ions impacted. So they are specialized in the detection of very small forces, and therefore they should be suited to detect textures as well, irritants. So we started working on this, developing this type of sensor because most tactile sensors in robotics are specialized, are suited for humanoid purposes, I'd say. But there are some applications, some more niche applications that could benefit from a much more sensitive sensor, from which we have identified the medical applications. A sensor similar to this was used in biometric monitorization of, in this case, heart rate. And in some industrial applications as well, we have tested this sensor for this type of sensor for food control. I'm not being able to. Okay. So, equivalently to the biological cilia, our cilia are made of a magnetic material, a magnetic composite that has a permanent magnetic characteristic. And when it bends, this characteristic is going to change. And the magnetic sensor underneath, the TMR sensor, which I'll explain later what it is exactly, can detect and transduce this deformation. So basically, there's a transaction between mechanical deformation to magnetic field and magnetic field into electrical signal. You can see here a small demonstration video, if I can start it. Sorry. Oops. Okay. So here you can see, so when the cilia bends to, when we bend the cilia to one side, you can see a signal being generated, a positive signal. When we build it, it has bipolar transaction. So when you bend the cilia to the other side, you see it changing. You see the signal changing to the opposite polarity. So the device is the composite is composed of a mixture of an elastomer. In this case, it is a PDMS with neodymium iron boron particles, which is a metallic alloy very well known for its magnetic remanence, high magnetic remanence. So not unlike what Professor Kawasetsu was presenting earlier today. And the cilia are prepared using a molding technique. So we produce a mold with very small holes made by laser cutting. And the magnetic PDMS is then poured into this mold, let to cure, while a high magnetic field, so 1 Tesla magnetic field, is applied in the axial direction of the cilia, so they acquire their magnetic characteristics. And then the whole cilia structure is separated from its glass substrate and from the mold itself, and undergoes an adhesion treatment so it can bond to the sensor die that we are using. Because the mold is made by laser cutting, we can use any cilia configuration we want. So in this case, we decided to test three configurations. One where we have just one single row of cilia, so with the sensitive direction of the sensor in this way. So meaning that the cilia will bend, let's say, on top of the sensor in this case. Then two using cilia matrices with 3x3 cilia. One with the larger cilia is using the configuration A, so 3 millimeter high by 400 micrometer diameter, and the configuration C is smaller cilia size of 1.6 millimeter high by 360 micrometer diameter. So the magnetic sensor underneath is a tunneling magnetoresistance sensor. So the sensing elements in this device are these small pillars. With in this case, with 2x20 micrometers of area, and in the z-axis they have a stack of magnetic alloys, and this specific stack of metallic alloys will change its resistance depending on the incident magnetic field, and that's how we transduce our magnetic signal. So we connect this sensing element to many other equal sensing elements in order to form sensing arrays. So the cilia will be so in this situation, so the cilia will be placed on top of the sensing elements, leaving the contact pads, of course, free to make electrical connections to the exterior. But these sensing elements are connected as sensing arrays, and our fabricated sensor is connected as a Wheatstone bridge. So some of the elements have positive slopes of magnetic field versus resistance, others have negative slopes. And what this will do is that it will create a bipolar signal on our device, so centered around zero and with positive voltages at positive fields and negative voltages at negative fields, which will facilitate very much the signal conditioning and the conversion later on. Finally, the third part of our sensor, besides the cilia and the magnetic sensor, is the signal conditioning and conversion board. So this is a board with approximately 2 centimeters by 1.5 centimeters that does all the signal processing. It takes the signal from the sensor, conditions it through a low-pass filter, provides offset compensation to further center our device's curve between the zero at zero voltage at the zero magnetic fields. And after doing this offset compensation, sends the signal to an ADC, 24-bit precision, where it will provide some gain and convert it to an I2C digital representation. So it can be easily connected to other microcontrollers. So the power consumption of this device while in active mode, of the whole device, sensor and board, is of 4.9 milliwatts at a 1,000 sample per second sample rate. And it has a micro power consumption at when it is not operating, so in sleep mode, of 15 microwatts. So we use this sensor to test the measurement, so to measure some textures. So we tested various types of sandpaper by making our sensor face the sandpaper surface at a fixed distance and making the cilia brush over the sandpaper at a constant velocity, in this case of 1 millimeter per second. So then we, with the signal for each type of sandpaper, we separated it into chunks of approximately 100 points, and we calculated the standard deviation for each of these chunks. And the signal was then basically correlated with the surface roughness for each type of sandpaper. And we can see there is a positive correlation for every configuration of sensor that we tested, although we can observe that for configuration B, we can see the greatest separation between the signal and surface roughness of each type of sandpaper. While for example, configuration C with a smaller cilia and configuration A with a single row of cilia, you can see there is some overlapping on some surface roughness points, especially the ones around 23 and 60 micrometers. Although all sensors could differentiate between the smallest surface roughnesses. Finally, we also tested pattern structures, so the same test as before, except now we tested a silicon piece with the pattern features of which we know their dimensions. So they have these patterned features with 200 micrometers width and with variable height. So some have 20 micrometers and others have 50 micrometers height. So configuration A with the single cilia row could resolve both the 20 and the 50 micrometer steps, and with a very good spatial resolution. So you can clearly see the peak generated by the step here. This image over here on the top side is scaled to the bottom side. So however, for configuration B with more cilia, we can see that the 20 micrometer step could not be resolved, and for the 50 micrometer step, although we can resolve it, it has a broadening of the characteristic due to its larger contact area. So with smaller contact areas clearly are favored in if you want to do a pattern scanning, a scanning of the surface topography of a sample. Configuration C with a smaller cilia, we could not see either step, so we didn't present the results here. So in conclusion, We developed a fully modular bio-inspired silitactile sensor that has low power consumption and all the data acquisition electronics required on board. This device was fully developed in-house and can be configured to fit specific sensing needs, as was shown for example, for pattern structures where the usage of larger and greater number of cilia improved the performance of the device, while for pattern structures, the usage of fewer cilia was desirable. That's it. Thank you for listening. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer.
Thanks a lot, Pedro, for the presentation. Thank you. Are there any questions? It's quite an amazing work. So maybe I'll ask a general question. So, you know, how difficult is it to produce these sensors? So if you were estimate, you know, one, when would you be able to share a couple, you know, of sensors with collaborators, or are they already kind of close to be on the stage when, you know, other people could try using them?
So these sensors are produced here at our laboratory. The design was already so validated. So we can produce them at scale. It takes some time to produce them, but we could produce them, for example, 100 or 200 at a time. So it would be fairly easy if someone wanted to use this type of sensor to share it to produce it here, and also in the event that a large scale production would be required. This process is the same process that is used to make read heads for hard drives. So it is a completely validated industrial process. So the fabrication would not be an issue in that sense.
Thanks a lot. There's one question in the chat from Dumgen. It's a very cool work. How sensitive are your surface sensing results to the distance of the sensor to the surface? I saw that it was fixed to 1 millimeter. What if it is closer?
So this isn't presented in this work, but in a previous work, so the closer the sensor is to the surface, the less sensitive it is. So there is a compromise between how close you want the sensor, because if it's too far, you risk losing contact with the surface. If it's too close, you start losing sensitivity, because the more the cilia bends, like the more resistance it creates to the bending force. So at 1 millimeter, we found like a good compromise, although you could go higher sensitivity if you could have a higher sensitivity if you got it farther from the surface. Although, yes, then you would risk losing contact with either the surface or you could risk losing contact with the surface of that you are testing.
I see. Thank you very much. All right. Thanks again.